Well, howdy y'all. Thank you for joining us again. I have the outstanding pleasure of interviewing a good friend of mine, Dr. Remle Crowe. Remle, you are now a, or soon to be, it is, let's see, March 1st, you're about to be a Texan. So congratulations on this monumental event in your life.
Welcome to the country of Texas.
Correct. Have we already issued you your firearm?
It's in the mail.
Good. Yeah, now we need to go teach you how to shoot it. That way you'll be above about half of the armed Texans in our state. You'll know what to do with it. Well, welcome to Texas. So first off, tell me what brought you to Texas. Why are you here, other than it's a wonderful state?
Besides the tacos.
And we can just stop there. Thank you for coming.
That's really the truth of the matter. No, I recently accepted a position as a research scientist and performance improvement manager with ESO.
So Remle, you just made it to Austin. I'd like to find out a little bit about what your path to Austin, to our great state, was. So where'd you grow up and how'd you get here? How'd you get involved with EMS?
Sure. So I grew up in Wake County, North Carolina, Raleigh. Okay. And actually I did no EMS there. I went to undergrad at American University in Washington, D.C. And while I was doing a study abroad in Mexico City, I got into a car accident. I wasn't injured, but they did put me into an ambulance, and I immediately decided this is something I want to do.
This is where the cool kids hang out.
Exactly. So I finished up my business degree in Washington, D.C., and packed my bags and moved back to Mexico City, where, you know, for 26 million people on a good night, there might be six ambulances out.
Wow.
And then EMT school there is about a year-long academy setting.
Yeah.
50 of us went into the class, about 7 of us actually finished a year later.
Kind of like Thunderdome?
Exactly. So it is a long academy setting.
Wow. So I want to come back to that, but growing up in North Carolina, what made you think about going to Washington, D.C. for college?
I always liked Spanish and different languages and different cultures, and I wanted to go to an area where I would have some exposure to different cultures, and Washington, D.C. seemed like a great place to do just that.
A little more. Well, Raleigh's actually a fairly diverse place for, you know, for the South. Spoken as a Texan, I can say that. All right. So you got a business degree. You started down the path of getting a business degree, and that led you to Mexico City. What were you doing in Mexico City? I mean, like, what kind of stuff were you doing there on your internship?
So when I did study abroad, I was still in business school, and that was my first year in Mexico. Then I got into the car accident, and I finished up my business degree, moved back to Mexico. I just enrolled in the Mexican Red Cross in EMT school, and then I needed a job to support this volunteer EMS habit I acquired. And I ended up working for a friend's aunt at Ford Motor Company.
Wow. So what were you doing at Ford?
Well, I started off yelling at dealers was my primary job. And then they said, hey, you know what? I think you'd be great for engineering. I'm like, well, I have a business degree. They're like, yeah, you'll be fine.
That's a perfect fit.
So I ended up moving over to powertrain engineering, where they put me in charge of quality improvement. And I ended up working on the Super Duty's clutch for a little while. Uh-huh. And then they turned me actually into a design engineer after that.
Wow. So you started, that's where you started working on quality improvement.
Yes. So I was trained as a green belt, and then later I was trained as a black belt in Six Sigma.
So what's that?
Six Sigma is a quality improvement methodology. There's a couple of big ones. So Six Sigma is one of the big ones. The one that's more common in healthcare is the Institute for Healthcare Improvements model.
Okay. Well, tell me about what the hell does Six Sigma mean? Where does that come from?
Six Sigma refers to a statistical term. It's about the bell curve. So as you get six standard deviations away from the mean, the odds of a defect are very, very, very low.
Okay. So, all right. So is it safe to say that that's another way of looking at variation?
It is a way. It's a way of reducing variation.
Okay. So from a manufacturing standpoint, variation, it seems like, is probably bad. When you're working on a clutch, it seems like the modern clutches, even on Fords, said as a Chevy guy, they got to be a fairly precise production, right? It seems like a lot can go on, so variation could blow your stuff up. That might be bad.
That's actually possible, yes.
Yeah.
You want to have very tight production and very similar pieces.
So Six Sigma is, and what does the sigma refer to? You mentioned a statistic.
It's a standard deviation.
A standard deviation, yeah. All right. So a measure of variation from the middle. And the idea is that three sides on three
plus
standard
three
deviations.
Minus three.
Okay. quality improvement. So I want to come back to that, because that seems to be something that you're making use of now. What did you do with the Red Cross? Tell me about that. That sounds like some pretty interesting experiences. You said six ambulances for the city of Mexico City?
Six ambulances from the Red Cross for the city of Mexico City. Their academy is the biggest. So the Red Cross is the primary EMS provider in Mexico, which is unusual compared to the U.S., right?
But and you don't mean just Mexico City. You mean
I mean
the country.
The country. And there's about 400 EMT schools across the country that are run by the Red Cross. I did attend headquarters school.
Okay.
And so that was, you applied for it like any school, had a couple of exams. They interviewed me twice and they're like, no, really, tell me why you're here. I want to do this here.
Yeah.
Okay, fine, you're in.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, what's an American like you doing in a place like this?
That was pretty much their their concern.
Huh.
And I mean, we used the orange book in Spanish.
Yeah. So. I just love the concept of an orthopedic surgeon talking about, well, anything other than orthopedic emergencies. Interesting. So you mentioned this is a volunteer gig, and people went through a year-long school.
And paid for it.
And so they paid you to take the school.
No, school cost money. I paid $100, $100 US a month, plus you had to purchase each piece of your uniform as you earned it.
Like, here is a sock.
That's actually exactly how it works. So on day one, the students come in black jeans and white t-shirts, and you have to have black socks and black boots, and your nails must be cut. You line up in the morning, pass roll call, and that's that. Then your whole team earns their pants at some point after they pass the first clinical exam.
But just to be clear, you're wearing pants before.
You're wearing black jeans, but you earn your blue cargo pants.
Okay. All right. Wow.
And then it's a big day when you earn your shirt. And it can be taken away from you at any point. And if it gets taken away from one of you, the whole generation loses it. And then that's a source of shame in the school.
Wow.
Yep.
You know, I hear a lot about paramedics now complaining. I thought I had it rough driving 100 miles each way for paramedic school. It sounds like maybe I should just shut the hell up.
Perhaps. There are definitely some things that I think we take for granted in the U.S. And especially when I came out of EMT school and was finally allowed to ride on the ambulance, one of the things I tell folks is that when I came to the U.S., it shocked me to open the back of an ambulance and see things in the shelves. Because in Mexico, you open the ambulance, it's completely empty. You are assigned one kit, and it might have a couple of roller bandages, some saline, some IV kits. Have a good night.
And that's it.
Yep, and then whatever else I managed to take from conferences in the U.S. and shoving my backpack full of stuff, I always had my own stuff, but that's all you had for the evening.
So you mentioned IVs. Were there paramedics there? Did the EMTs do the IVs? How did that work?
So at the time I practiced, there were very few paramedics. There were about 50 in the country. That has since changed.
Wow.
I was in EMT school, but the EMTs had advanced scope, so I could do IV and IO, but rarely was IO available.
Okay. You can do it. You don't have it,
And if you have medications, which would be unlikely. I mean, I used a CardioLife 4 more times than not.
That's a good cardio workout, moving that around.
You have to plug it into the wall to actually get it to shock, so hope there's an outlet nearby.
And the lights in the building dim.
Yeah, and the EKGs in the hospital still have the little balloons in the metal clips.
Oh, those are nice. Talk about hickeys all over your legs.
Yeah, exactly.
Interesting.
Yep, so I did work on one of two ALS rigs for the city, so I was lucky in that sense. That ambulance was fully stocked, it had a Life Pack 12, and I had a medic.
Wow.
But it's not like the U.S., so the most experienced person actually ends up driving and giving orders to the EMT in the back. So I was very comfortable with critical patients, but then when I got to the U.S., I was very uncomfortable with driving, which as an EMT turns out to be a problem.
You mentioned quality improvement. You started doing that with Ford. You're doing some of that now, and you are a research scientist. So where did you go from Mexico? It seems like you kind of wanted to go back to school, some more school stuff.
That's also a fun story. So when I was on vacation from Ford, on my regular job, I decided to go to EMS Today.
Okay.
And there was a research luncheon, and I said, hey, that sounds pretty cool. I'm going to go to a research luncheon. And I was in my Mexican Red Cross uniform, and I listened to somebody present on sepsis. I stood up and asked a question about their research, and immediately a person started walking towards me. Turned out he was the executive director of the National Registry of EMTs. His first question is, do you have a degree? I said, yeah, I have a bachelor's in business. He's like, I need you to apply for this fellowship. oh, okay. What it turned out to be was the National Registry of EMT has an EMS fellowship program for researchers,
yeah,
where they train EMTs or paramedics off the street at a master's level and then a PhD level to do actual EMS research. And I ended up applying for that job, and 5 years later, here I am.
So I want to talk a little bit more about that, because I think what the registry is, I think the registry, people get frustrated with their exam because we always get frustrated when we have to take an exam.
Absolutely.
But I think they're doing some amazing things for us. But I'm really impressed with this program. So tell us a little bit more about this. You're getting a PhD, you're being paid, they pay for your school, they give you a job, and they give you an opportunity to do a crap ton of actual research.
That's exactly what it is. So it is a very unique opportunity in that, again, EMTs and paramedics are taken off the street who have a degree. They are put through the master's and PhD program at The Ohio State University. And you have a full-time job at the National Registry, where you have access to a lot of survey data as well as the actual National Registry's database.
Yeah.
So from day one, you are actually doing research using a statistical software package and diving right in.
Wow.
And by the time you graduate, you have usually about 10 to 20 publications in peer-reviewed journals.
I was going to say, I've seen your CV. It's fairly impressive.
It was a very unique opportunity. And so actually the way the program came about is pretty interesting. It was a way for the National Registry to give back to the community. So in the national research agenda, there was a call for, you know what, any of the research that is happening in EMS, which is few and far apart as far as studies go, is being conducted by physicians.
Yeah.
Not to say that's a problem, but we would like to see trained EMS practitioners performing EMS research. So they said, you know what, we're going to contribute to that cadre of trained professionals, and we are going to fully fund this program. So education is fully funded, and you have a full-time job.
Wow. So how many of these fellows have there been?
So there, I am the third graduate.
Trace your lineage back.
I am the third graduate. The first graduate was Dr. Jonathan Studnick, and he is at Mecklenburg EMS Agency.
Okay.
And then Dr. Tony Fernandez is at the EMS Performance Improvement Center in North Carolina.
Wow.
So both still doing great things for EMS research.
Yeah, absolutely. That's awesome. So you got your PhD, and your PhD is in epidemiology. So that means you're a dermatologist, right?
Yes, I study the skin and zombies.
Outstanding. And zombies.
Zombie skin. That's what I study.
Well, it turns out the CDC is very interested in zombies now.
Yes.
Seriously, what is epidemiology? What is that?
So epidemiology is the study of health in populations.
Okay. And what the hell does that mean?
That means that we like to look upstream for the issues. So when we're working in EMS, we are often dealing with the immediate problem. But in epidemiology, we like to look at problems that affect populations. So things like socioeconomic status, what is the housing conditions like? If you have asthma, you know, we can treat the asthma as EMTs.
Right.
We'll give you albuterol, no big deal.
But if you
have cockroaches, or if you have housing that's moldy or wet, you're not solving the root cause of the problem. And so epidemiology looks at population issues and these social determinants of health and tries to change it from that angle. Whereas EMS, I like working one person at a time.
Outstanding. So what's some of the, so you did, you have to do a dissertation to graduate. Tell us about your dissertation. What work did you do there?
So for my dissertation topic, I chose burnout in EMS. And specifically, I wanted to show that burnout in EMS is likely an organizational characteristic. Traditionally, when we hear burnout, we hear things like, oh, we need resilience training, the individual needs to cope better. But to me, that is blaming the victim.
Okay.
Really, the things that are causing and generating burnout can be treated at an organizational level. And my work, some of the interesting things are that it's showing things like pay and benefits, of course they matter, but those aren't the big predictors of burnout.
Okay.
The predictors of burnout tend to be these softer cultural aspects. So do you get respect from your supervisor? Have you received feedback from your medical director? Those are associated with much greater odds of not having burnout versus some of these pay and benefits things.
So I was just in your talk at the Eagles meeting, and as you were talking about this and specifically talking about the feedback from your medical director, furiously scribbling notes to self, that's really interesting that feedback from a medical director can decrease burnout. Sounds like we have, as medical directors, some more work to do.
And it's been shown that in the hospital setting as well. So medical walk rounds with medical students has been shown to reduce burnout as well. So I think that's something that doesn't require a huge investment of resources, but could have a huge impact on provider burnout. it provides validation for what you do. It's a learning experience. We like to keep learning. And I think that it's something that is not done so frequently in EMS.
Interesting. I want to go back and talk a little bit more about something you said, because we do talk a lot about resilience. And I think I have the same gut reaction that I kind of heard from you. So the things that we hear about resilience, and we hear about this in EMS, we hear about this in the emergency department and in the hospital. Resilience means you need to find better coping skills. So what I got from you is maybe that's not really the best approach.
So I don't think that's the best approach. I think that the model that I use to describe burnout is called the job demands resources model, and that says that burnout is generated due to a prolonged imbalance where job demands exceed job resources. So something like feedback from your medical director would be classified as a job resource, whereas call volume might be classified as a job demand. And so I think job resources are definitely something that can be modified at the organizational level, and that it should be treated as such.
So the two variables then, we can decrease the demands but increase the resources.
And sometimes the demands are not in your control. Call volume, you can't necessarily tell people call at a more convenient hour.
If you don't mind.
I mean, if you don't mind. But what you can do is implement medical director walk-arounds once a month. So I think, you know, a lot of the research has been focused on, well, maybe you need to meditate more, let's do yoga, let's do physical fitness. All of these are good things, but that is blaming the individual or making it an individual's problem, when burnout really is an organizational problem, and it's linked to organizational issues like turnover, injury, and sickness absence. So all of these things leave vacant shifts and have to do with recruitment and retention, and so it really should be paid attention to at an organizational level.
Interesting. I saw a thing on Twitter. There was one ER doc who was feeling a little overwhelmed, and she said, if you say the word resilience one more time, I'm going to beat you about the head with your frickin' downward dog. Yoga is not the solution for boarding 180 patients in the emergency department. Outstanding. So I think we're running out of time here. So we can either have a fascinating discussion about how you calculate p-values, or we can do something that I think may be a little more beneficial. Let's say that there was a 21-year-old newly minted paramedic. Hypothetically speaking, we could just say he went to Texas A&M, and he was really interested in research. What advice would you give to young Jeff? I mean, this hypothetical paramedic. So you're interested in research, you have no idea how to get involved, you have no idea how to read it, you have no idea where to start. What would you suggest?
I'd suggest there's a lot of places to start. So I think that there are a couple of good columns in the trade journals, so EMS World or GEMS, where researchers review research articles from peer-reviewed. So that brings them down and makes them more accessible, takes out the scary statistics terms, and shows you what are the clinical important findings.
Okay.
I think another solution is just to go to the peer-reviewed journals, give it a try. I still skip over crazy statistics terms because I don't think that they're necessarily as important as the findings. Of course, I can read a percentage in a table, and often practical relevance is much more important to me than statistical significance.
Yeah. There was something that you said earlier that made me think about this phrase, that just because you can do a very complex statistical test doesn't mean you should.
Exactly. It's nice to put big fancy statistical words into a paper, but at the end of the day, if you can't communicate your findings and the implications of your findings, then you're not doing a service with your research.
Yeah, nice. I think it was Einstein who said, if you can't explain your concept in a short elevator trip, you don't understand it well enough.
Right, or if you can't explain it to a six-year-old, then you don't know what you're talking about.
Or maybe it was Richard Feynman. So I like that idea. Having had, is always that reviewer three, kick back something to me, telling me some crazy statistical nonsense. I'm like, look, I'm just an Aggie. I don't get that.
And if you look at some of the best peer-reviewed journals like JAMA or the New England Journal of Medicine, what you'll see is that most of the analyses are pretty simple. They will do, you know, fancy statistics here and there, but the communication of the findings is very simple. And so starting with some of those bigger journals is a good idea. Also recommend doing journal clubs. So there are a number of electronic journal clubs, like the Pre-Hospital Care Research Forum has one. I would recommend starting there because you have people you can ask, well, what does this really mean? Does this matter? Should I understand this?
So I'm glad you brought up PCRF.
Yep.
So they do a webinar once a month. It's on one of the Mondays of the month. take a look at it. I think that's a very approachable way to get involved with research. Well, perfect. Well, Dr. Crowe, thank you very much for sitting down with us.
Thanks
I appreciate
me.
It. And thank you for the, I've sat in on some of your lectures where you're trying to explain statistics to folks, and you do a great job of it. And you have done a wonderful job of holding my hand and trying to explain why just because you can program that statistic in doesn't make it the right program.
Don't push the button.
That's right. Awesome. Remle, thank you very much.
Thank
I appreciate
you.
It.